God, thank you for the gift of new life and resurrection. Help us celebrate with joy. Thank you for creating the path for our transformation in Christ. Help us bring all of our brokenness to you, especially times we have turned away from you and our neighbors. We admit that we need this transformation.
Help us put our mistakes to rest in the
Now the good news. from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 16, verses 1 through 8. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Salome, bought spices so that they go and anoint the body of Jesus. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance of the tomb?" But when they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already fallen back. As they bravely entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. For the young man said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Look, there is the place where they laid him. But now go," the young man told the women who had joined him in the empty tomb. "Go and tell his disciples and tell Peter that Jesus is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as Jesus told you." So the women went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Praise be to God. Happy Easter and good morning. Obviously, I'm not Pastor Liz. I hope that's obvious. And as was Karen shared earlier, Pastor Liz is ill and not able to join us this morning. And she does ask that we continue to hold her in prayer. And we do. I also understand, somewhat by eavesdropping, that when it was known that Pastor Liz could not be here today, the usual routine, the usual steps were taken to try to find someone to fill in Christian circles and pastoral circles. That's called pulpit supply, which is a phrase I just always disliked. Pulpit supply, it sounds to me like I should be selling staples and sticky notes or something like that. But apparently, because it's Easter Sunday, there wasn't anyone available. So you get the bottom of the barrel. But part of that's because I'm Pastor Joel. I pastor this church called The Loft, and we meet here on Sunday mornings after Readington Reformed Church has had their service. And so I'm kind of a neighbor, and I was invited, and I'm delighted to be able to be here. The title of the sermon, which was, Pastor Liz's title is Why Be a Christian? And that could be, tone of voice can do a lot. I mean, that could just be, why be a Christian? It could be, why be a Christian, right? It could be, why be a Christian? What does this mean? Why be a Christian? And there's some sense of understanding what is going on. What is the reality of the Easter message, in essence, is what it comes down to. Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians, if Jesus is not raised from the dead, then your faith is pointless. But if Jesus is raised from the dead, that's the most astonishing thing that can be imagined. One of the reasons for believing that, as has been passed down through the many centuries, but it begins with a group of eyewitnesses, people like Peter and Thomas and Paul and Matthew, for whom there is abundant historic documentation. The letters of Paul are well attested to historically. And all of these people who claim to be eyewitnesses met tragic ends. They were all sacrificed, crucified, martyred. And not one of them facing the cross themselves or being beheaded or other cruel things I don't want to talk about this Sunday morning. Not one of them said, okay, wait a minute. We were really only kidding. It's really all just a political plot. How many of those people faced death without recanting the truth of what they experienced? And even someone like Peter, he says in one of his letters, hey, look, I know what I'm talking about. I was there. I saw this guy with my own eyes. I was with him on the Mount of Transfiguration. I heard the voice of God. Paul tells us that during the period of time between Jesus' resurrection and his ascension into heaven, his bodily ascension into heaven, that there were more than 500 people who had encounters with him during that time. And these are the stories of faith that were then shared and transferred and given from one group to the next. But we also lose sight of the fact that besides the testimony of eyewitnesses, because really, what has that to do with somebody three generations later? What has that to do with the couple of billion Christians who are on this planet today? Billions. There are billions of human beings on this planet today who attest that Jesus Christ is the risen Lord. They didn't have a chance to talk to Peter and receive the enthusiasm of that eyewitness account. So who is the witness to us? Who is the witness in our current day? And Jesus told us on his last night with his disciples, it's good for you that I go away. I have to go away so that the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, can come and be with you. It's the Holy Spirit that does the job of witnessing to us, to our hearts, to our spirit, and to our minds. That is one of the gifts of salvation. It's not just an idea. It's not just an intellectual agreement. It's not only a tradition that a certain group of people hold to. It's either a living reality, as the Apostle Paul alludes to, or we're all fools. I've had some foolish days in my life, times in my life when I've acted like a fool. But my faith in Jesus Christ and my faith in his word have been witnessed to, have been encouraged, and have been strengthened by my walk with the Lord. Oh, these last, dare I say, 50 years. Can I believe that I've been walking with the Lord for 50 years? I remember when I turned 50, and that was a little while ago. Just saying. But to me, the answer to the question, why be a Christian, is addressed in many ways in one of the most familiar and maybe even elementary passages of Scripture. And I'm going to turn to the Gospel of John, chapter 3, verses 16 and 17. In your pew Bible, it's page 864 if you want to go there, but it's only two verses, And many of us may already know these verses. I know these verses in the King James Version because they were drilled into my head when I was a kid in Sunday school. But John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him might not perish, but have eternal life. 17, indeed, God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world through him might be saved. I was reading that one day, and many of us, you'll speak to people who may have testimonies of, I was just reading some familiar passage, or is reading a devotional, and as though the words were lit by phosphorus, the words just jumped off the page. I've read them 10,000 times, and suddenly it's like, boink, the word just jumped off the page. It's like, wow, I never saw it that way before. If that's ever happened to you, by the way, that's a manifestation of the presence of the Holy Spirit. For God so loved the world. You know, there's a little bit of, there's a sequence here. It's not a little bit. It's not quite a chronology. But it says, God loved the world. He loves the world so much that he did something. He did something about it. And it tells us that what God did is he sent his Son so that. And what God spoke to me when I was reading it on that day when it lit up like phosphorus, he said, just stop for a second. I don't want to be too familiar, but sometimes the Lord addresses me as Davis. Wait a minute, Davis. Read that over with me. I guess that's an old affectionate thing from my youth. God loved the world so much. And what he said to me is, I love you. And I cannot love you more. There's nothing you can do, Davis, that would cause me to love you more. I have already given everything that I can. Conversely, at the same time, Davis, there's nothing you can do that would cause me to love you less. Because my love for you springs out of my very nature. The Word tells us God is love. God did not choose Israel to be his messengers to the earth because they were better, brighter, more accomplished, holier, more obedient, more willing than anyone else. If anything, we read through Scripture. My Jewish friends, I was born and raised in Queens, my Jewish friends would say, oy vey. How often is Israel referred to as a stiff-necked, stubborn, hard-hearted people? But they were chosen because of God's promises and his love for Abraham and his descendants. And God made a promise to Abraham that through him the whole world would be blessed. So the notion, we can have a little button, God loves you. Smile, right? It's not God loves you. And that's absolutely true, I would say. It is by definition true. And we sometimes respond to that revelation or that realization or that message, we respond to it as though, well, there you go. Okay, that's it. God loves me. Now what? But there is a now what. It says, God loved me so much that he sent his son. And he sent his son for a particular purpose. And it says the reason he sent his son is so that when I believe in Jesus, I can experience something called eternal life. I've had it explained to me that that doesn't just mean living for a long time. That eternal life is life from heaven. Eternal life is life from the very throne of God. Eternal life is the kind of life that we experience in God. And it's not something that's meant just for us to hold our breath until we die. Eternal life is a condition into which we can enter and into which we are called because of Jesus Christ. And that really is attested to in the next verse. It says, God did not send his son into the world to condemn us. Oh, doing that wrong. No, did that wrong. No, you'll never make it. Christ was not sent among us so that we could become discouraged by the enormity of the distance between where we are and where God is, which is to that which we are called. That's ridiculous. So what's going on here? Well, just to share, again, it's another one of these phosphorus moments for me. God sent his son into the world so that the world through him might be saved. And I was doing the words because I was, especially as a kid, I was, what does this saved mean? You know, brother, are you saved? I believe in Jesus, but what am I saved? What's saved? And the explanation really I only ever got was, well, you're not going to go to hell. You're rescued from hell. Okay, I guess that is a good thing, obviously. But I hope I have a long time to go before I cash in that chip. C-H-I-T. So I did a word study on this word saved. And in the Greek, the word there is, we would pronounce it as sozo. We'd spell it S-O-Z-O. Sozo. If you had a friend named Zorro and you were greeting him one day, you might say, sozo, how you doing?
Sozo.
Just, that's how I remember it. Well, interesting thing, this word sozo in the Greek is at the root of every word in the New Testament that has anything to do with salvation. Saved, savior, salvation, all of those words come from this Greek word sozo. So I can say to you that salvation, to any time you see the word saved, it is always the Greek word sozo. However, The Greek word sozo isn't always saved. It is translated differently in a lot of different places. And we're not going to do the whole Bible study, although that's really great because it would take a while, but I'll just, some stories you're probably familiar with. The woman who had the issue of blood, and she'd been going to doctors for years, and she knew that if she could only touch the hem of Jesus' garment, he could heal her because he was the Messiah. And she reaches out and she touches the hem of his garment, and the power of healing flowed out of Jesus into the woman with the issue of blood, and she was healed on the spot. And if you can imagine the situation, this is Jerusalem, it's like Times Square on New Year's Eve. There's crowds of people, and Jesus turns and says, "Who touched me?" And his disciples look at him incredulously, "Who touched you? What do you mean, who touched you? There's thousands of people here." But he felt the power of healing flow out of him into this woman. And she sheepishly, I imagine, raises her hand and says, "Well, it was I touched you." And Jesus turns to her and says, "Your faith has made you whole." Guess what Greek word is translated as "made you whole"? Sozo. Other places in Scripture, sozo is translated as delivered, healed, rescued. So if we do a little word exchange, if A equals B and B equals C kind of thing, God did not send his Son into the world that the world would be condemned, but that the world through him might be made whole. That the world through him might be healed. That the world through him might be delivered. One reason I'm a Christian is God has healed me. God has delivered me. As I have walked with the Lord over these years, it wasn't just all one time, poof, brother, now you're saved, go ye forth and be ye perfect. But the work of the Holy Spirit, the power of the blood of Jesus, the redeeming influence of the presence of the Word of God in my life has changed my heart, has changed my thinking, has changed my mind, has healed my emotions. And the scriptures that were shared earlier where Paul says, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, and so on. And in that verse, Paul is saying, is not saying these are attributes to which you need to aspire. You know, you got to work on your patience, right? No, that's not what it says. Paul says these types of characteristics, the fruit, what is the fruit of the apple tree? Well, it's an apple. Well, how much blood, sweat, and tears does the apple tree shed producing apples? Well, really, it just kind of happens. Apple trees make apples. Peach trees make peaches. The Holy Spirit in our lives produces his characteristics. But he brings that through this process often of being healed, being made whole, being delivered. Well, delivered from what? And just our human nature. The triggers that result in outbursts of anger. the harsh words that just blurt out of our mouths that cut and dig. The fears that hold us and restrain us, the indulgences that we regret, and on and on and on. We could take a survey, you know, whatever it happens to be. Those aren't just bad behaviors that you ought to be ashamed of. And if you only bit your bottom lip harder, you can get over it. Grit your teeth harder. Those are the things from which the blood of Jesus was shed, that we may be set free. Healed. Delivered. Rescued. So why be a Christian? I would say, let's be a Christian that we may have life and have it more abundantly. Let's be a Christian that we can have the hope of eternal life, not merely in the resurrection of the dead. You say, wait a minute, don't you have that backwards? Hey, you know, I'm in Christ. I'm going to be raised someday. But God has placed within me a hope. For how is he at work in my life today? How am I being delivered more and more? Lord, help me to walk with you, to turn my heart toward you. As the song goes, help me to love what you love, that I can walk with you, purchased by the blood of Christ and robed in his righteousness all the way. Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Oh,
Jesus, alive from the dead, transforms us. As we open to this transformation, we become people who are more loving, joyful, patient, peaceful, kind, generous, faithful, gentle, and self-controlled. Didn't I just preach this? Praise God. May your giving today reflect this transformation. Give as you are able, as people already on their way to God-given transformation. Today, we worship together as Jesus would have us, sharing the good news across churches and denominations. All loose offering will be divided between Readington Reformed Church and the Loft Church. If you are using a giving envelope or tithe envelope, the church that you designate on the envelope will receive your offering. I ask the ushers to collect our tithes and offerings. Risen Lord, thank you for taking our fears and transforming them into wonder. Bless our gifts today to transform the world for your sake and in your name. Make us bold to declare that new life is available for all. We come before you this morning, Father, invited by you, through the blood of Christ, to present to you our hearts, our petitions, our supplications. Lord, we lift to you any of those in our lives, in this congregation, or the Loft congregation, Lord, who are in need of physical healing, encouragement, emotional encouragement, Father. We lift to you also today those who are within our community, who are in need of additional help and support. I thank you, Father, that part of the mission of this church is to contribute to families in need in this area and in this community. We lift to you, Lord, the conditions of our nation that has the appearance of being deeply divided on so many issues. And we pray, Father, for this nation, that there would be a time of healing and wisdom that would prevail. Likewise, Lord, around the world, so many places that are in turmoil, conflict, the Ukraine and Russia, issues going on in Israel and Syria, two or three places in Africa where there's armed conflict, even now as we speak. We pray for these things, Father. Although these things may seem to be removed from us and far away, the world in which we live, Lord, is so closely knit that events that are taking place literally halfway around the world suddenly have an impact on our daily lives. We pray for the people, Lord, who have lost their lives and the families that are grieving in all of those situations. Father, lastly, we thank you that what we celebrate on Easter is new life, is new hope. Most importantly of all, it is an eternal hope, a hope of an eternal kingdom where justice and goodness and love is what paves the streets. We thank you also, Lord, for the hope of your presence in our lives, that in each one of us, the imminent presence of God would become more real, and that we would recognize, as we read today in John 3, that God so loves us, that he cannot love us more. So we come before you today, Father, and in all these things we pray as the Lord Jesus taught us to pray. If you pray with me, please. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. with all the saints. What is the breadth and length and height and depth? And to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, so that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now to him who by the power at work within us is able to accomplish abundantly far more than all we can ask or imagine, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations, forever and ever. Amen. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May he cause his face to shine upon you and give you peace. Amen. Happy Easter.